what we actually do for that young people.
It's very bothering when you think about, you know, for some of the backgrounds and some of the issues are there, but, you know, just, if he was a decent footballer, you know, you might be sad about something.
I don't think any way for you to be with me.
That was a debate.
You just have.
I have to come in further recommendation on that before then.
Yes.
Okay, item six is the IRP update. Again,
Chair, I'll be very brief, really. First of the course is to kind of update members around you to manage the planning process of the town line so far. And the recommendation is that members note the planning process and the timetable and to approve the publication of the IRP update, which is contained within Appendix A on page 123. And it has, the Chief has alluded to, you know, the statement of assurance is a little bit of a backward-looking document. The IRP and the service delivery plans are a little bit more forward-looking than what we intend to do. But as I say, the timeline of progress is captured within page 121. But where we're at this moment in time is we're starting to kind of develop our functional plan to inform our decision plans, and then they will be captured as part of the service delivery plan moving forward, which will be brought back for the authority to sign off on the 22nd of the 18th, which will be implemented then. The other aspect of the ask for members is that the update, which is contained within page 123, is considered and, well, it's agreed and approved that we would upload that onto the website for members of the public to kind of peruse. That's about 10 hours. And I can see any questions, Chair, if you have any questions.
Any questions or comments on that? Anybody calls? No? Thank you. You can make a couple of recommendations.
Please.
Yeah, please. Sure, right. Yeah.
Thank you. Okay. Item 7 is the variation on the fire transformation grant.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. Again, members will recall when we initially got information from the stations, we went out to government to secure some fire transformational grant funding. So, therefore, the purpose of this report is to inform members of the Home Office have agreed to a variation in the use of the fire transformation funding. Part of the station manager program. Members will recall when we initially went out and secured that funding, we made six stations into three. Clearly, more recently, we've seen the closure of our fire station rather than the merging of with speed fire station, which was a potential option for us at the point in time. As a result of that, they've given us calls to go back to the Home Office and say, well, you granted us funding on the basis of merging six stations, the likelihood of now, or the inevitable now, is the merging of four stations and the closure of one. Some of the kind of broader changes will be made and afforded anyway. Or is it the right and fit for us to return to them to say to them, well, okay, are you still content that we would utilise the funding that was received up until this point to conclude the kind of transformation? As a result of ongoing discussions and quite lengthy discussions, Home has come back to us more recently and said they were happy to approve that. And on the basis of that, that's important to update members around the kind of the changes. But the actual specific changes are as detailed on page 144 on the project variation, which I won't read verbatim, but it talks about the closing of Upton West area stations and the creation of a new station for Torquay Massey, closing of St Anne's and Eccleston stations and the creation of a new station in St Anne's town centre. The actual physicality of the closing of Alton Fire Rescue Station, and then the co-location with Merseyside Police at Northwest and Northwest Ambulance Service at Formby Fire Station, again, which is progressing well. So, you know, as, on the basis of that, the Home Office were happy to agree the variation and the members to note. And I'm happy to take any questions on that, Chair.
Okay, thanks. Any questions or comments on that? It's a good outcome, actually. Okay, can we approve the recommendation? Okay, item 8 is the proposed fire station.
Thanks, Chair. The purpose of this report, members, is to seek your approval to proceed with the scheme to build a new fire station at Sawgrove Massey Road, which would replace the existing stations at Alton and West Kirby. It is fair to say, members, that you are all well aware of the background to this issue. I think even the Police Crime Commissioner is probably aware of the background to this particular issue. It needs to be fairly reported. However, for completeness, the background is set out in paragraphs 3 through 20, which is on pages 149 to 152. What I will bring your attention to, members, please, is to paragraphs 19 and 20. The land at Sawgrove Massey Road has been valued at £42,000. That was a jointly commissioned valuation by Lambert Smith Hampton, by ourselves and Royal Metropolitan Council. And the decision to transfer the land to the authority was taken by Will on the 27th of November. That decision was not called in, therefore, subject to approval at this meeting today, the project can proceed. Paragraphs 21 to 23 set out the next steps in the event that members approve the decision to proceed. Wait to undertake site investigation preparatory work, which could take in the region of 5 to 6 months, and that would be prior to any building work commencing. As we're aware from a fairly numerous capital schemes we've delivered now over the last few years, the build phase for the fire station typically is around 12 months. As members will be aware, the revenue savings from the merger proposal have already been delivered through retirements. This saving dates back to financial year 15-16. It's just taken so long to get to this point. The capital cost of the scheme is set out in paragraphs 28 to 32, which is on pages 153 and 154. The estimated build cost is £4.7 million, and that includes costs which we've already incurred up to this point, for example, the planning applications, designs, redesigns, surveys, etc. Points made at paragraph 29 that this cost is an estimate, which could change dependent on the outcomes of the site survey, as, for example, has been the case with Prescott, and no doubt will be the case with St Helens. Additional costs are set out in paragraph 30, which bring the overall cost to an estimated £4.8 million. Funding arrangements for the scheme are set out in paragraph 31. The capital programme contains a provision of £4.2 million for the scheme, which means we'll have to increase the contribution from the capital reserve by £600,000. The contribution then from the capital reserve, including the increase of £600,000, would be £2.164 million. The balance of £2.636 million is split between £2.086 million from the Transformation and Efficiencies Funding, which Phil has just spoken to on the previous report, and an estimated £550,000 for the sale of Upton and West Kirby. Paragraph 32 sets out that £60,000 of the £297,000 revenue funded received from DCLG as an element of the Transformation and Efficiencies Grant has been used to pay for the consultation process and advice received in the early stages of the project. The only other point I'd make at this juncture, members, is that that's set out in paragraph 34, which is that the merger will not improve cover compared to what was now the former operational provision of having operational stations at Upton and West Kirby. But as members are well aware, we have not been able to free West Kirby for quite some time now, that's been reported previously. Therefore, the move to Sawgrove Massey absolutely does improve the cover arrangements that exist currently, i.e. responding only from Upton. I'll pause at that point, members, and just take any questions that you might have.
Okay, thanks. Is there any questions or comments on the ground?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Thank the Chief Fire Officer for the report. I'm obviously very happy to support the recommendation to go ahead with the building of the new fire station. But I'm just a little bit concerned at reading the report and listening to what Dan said, that the original recommendation to approve the fire station was subject to a certain amount of opposition, and then it went to a site visit, the decision was delayed. So what I'm concerned about, Chair, is has it cost us extra money because of the time lost from the original recommendation to the final approval being given? And if so, is the Chief Fire Officer able to give us any figures as to how much money it has cost because of the delay?
So to answer Councillor Kenny's question, undoubtedly there has been a cost as a direct result of the delays and through the opposition. Absolutely there has. To quantify that cost, you are probably looking at it is well into six figures, it's probably in the order of it will be in excess of £100,000. We would need to go away and break that down in detail, but certainly it feels to me it's something of that order.
With regards to paragraph 14, it states that the planning committee attached a condition requiring an archaeological evaluation of the site to determine whether or not it was an A&H settlement. I was wondering if there's been any updates on that.
Subject to it, like there's nothing to suggest that we are sitting on the site of an A&H settlement. However, once assuming members approve of the recommendation of the report, then that's part of the work that we're to undertake, which is hence this potentially up to 6 months further delay in settlements and so forth. But just to reassure Councillor Roberts, at this juncture, I am not aware of any IMA settlements. But let me not counting my chickens on that one.
Just on this, that's been quite a long drawn out process, and something that the authority agreed some 2 years ago. Yeah. And I think it's been unfortunate that there's been so much delay on the progress of this particular major. And I think that there's been some shenanigans played by certain individuals from the local council, the local councils in particular. And I think that it's been difficult for us when we would read the financial consequences of the authority, and for that to cost us in excess of £100,000, I think they need to ask themselves, why did they place the public sector like the Fire and Rescue Service through so much long protracted opposition when our aim has solely been to ensure that we have appropriate emergency response to those residents of Westville. Nothing else, no other agenda, not like some individuals, no other agenda other than being professional. And our officers have always been professional and conducted themselves in the highest standards that they would expect. Not like some councils who are involved with this application of force. And just to put on record, again, our thanks and appreciation to all our staff who have been engaged with this over the last 2 years. And now that we're at the position where we can now proceed, albeit not finding any artifacts that might stop us in any way, but we can proceed this and ensure that those residents will receive the best possible response on behalf of the Fire and Rescue Service. So that has always been. Okay, item 9 is the Defence Employer Recognition Scheme.
Thank you, Chair. The purpose of this report is to update members on the Defence Employer Recognition Scheme Silver Award and to seek members' support for future application for the Gold Award. The background of the Defence Employer Recognition Scheme is set out in paragraphs 3 to 5. Which is on page 155. Our bid for the Silver Award was very kindly endorsed by Councillor Ian Francis, who is the Armed Forces Champion for the Liverpool City Council. Paragraph 7 set out the evidence which was advanced in support of our successful application. And Gary, who's to my right, he's just come up with the award itself. Gary and Watch Manager Ron Duffy received the award at a presentation in Manchester on the 23rd of November. And officers are now considering the criteria for the Gold Award, and we are of the view that we believe that we could submit evidence sufficient to meet the criteria for the Gold Award, and therefore we now seek member approval to do so. I will pause at that point, members, to take any questions, but just to say, as a former soldier myself, I am particularly delighted that we've received this recognition, and I would strongly endorse you supporting this recommendation.
Yes, thank you. At paragraph 6, it says that Councillor Francis, who's a Liverpool champion, offered support, but it also says the staff at the 156 Regimental RLC. Now, they're represented in Sefton as well, Allerton Road as well, but also over in Birkenhead. And this is a pan-Mersey side. Out in Highton, there's elements of Signals and Royal Logistics Corps. There's a complete across-Mersey. And of course, in Merseyside, we have a Naval Reserve, a Marine Reserve, which is not represented across much else of the country. We have a famous tradition of military service, reserve and full-time within Merseyside. We need to support those, not just veterans, but those people who are currently in the reserve forces, in the forces, reserve and regular. And also that their families, they may be detached abroad, they may well be back home now. Within the reserve forces, we've been adapting homes for returning injured service people. Our prisons have many, unfortunately, service people residing within them. And we have a duty to all of those people. And I think this award scheme and the military covenant, not just about those organisations who have reservists and full-time, but it's also for the families thereof and those people who might want to call on our services. It's a very good scheme, covers the whole of Merseyside, and we should get right behind this.
I think Councillor Francis is actually preparing a motion on this for the January of the full council.
The purpose of this report is to update members on the progress of the working group, which was established to consider the proposed reform of the authority. The background of the report is set out in paragraphs 4 to 8, which is on page 159 to 160. Paragraph 9, updates on the meeting that the chair and I held with the Mato Mayor, the outcomes of which is a request from the Mato Mayor for officers to set out options for governance of the Fire Rescue Service, and the same ask has been made of the Chief Constable to do likewise for the police. In light of the work commissioned by the Mato Mayor, the chair has taken the decision to suspend the working group until such time as the outcomes of that work is known. At the report, just is to advise the members of that, that position. So I will pause at that point. Maybe the chair is better placed to take questions than I am.
I think members are all in the report. The initiative was welcome out of the first had set out our proposals and the consultation that we had with the district leaders and the Metro Mayor. One of the things that I was keen to do is to have a meeting with the Metro Mayor, which you know we gladly facilitated with his chief executive and some of this time. And once we went through the discussions of what possibilities are there for further devolution, devolved powers of the Metro Mayor, and we looked at other examples of what's happened in Greater Manchester, what's happened in the West Midlands, and what's happened with Greater London, and how we fit in that, and how we go forward in the future. And because of the some of the areas going through a bit of a learning curve at the moment, and there's some obstacles that have been placed in the way, I didn't want to profile our approach being placed in a position that would compromise our future as an authority or even as a committee, if that's the case, if that goes forward in future years. And there was the other element of the, because of the financial issues that we face, is that there was that financial saving that we could have achieved. But nevertheless, I think that for the transparency, accountability, and democracy, and the representation from the five district councils across from Merseyside, I thought it was important that we ensure that this we need to get this right. And I was, the dialogue that we've now opened with the Metro Mayor and the senior officers of the combined authority, our working group has been established to look at the next tranche of devolved powers, which obviously the police are involved with that and ourselves involved with that, that the senior officers are also invited to that to ensure that they put our respective views to the working party, so that they have an understanding of the fantastic work that we undertake, like some of the items that have been on today's agenda, just to highlight, it's not just about fire and rescue service going out on fires, it's everything else that we undertake. It's the added value, it's not just about saving lives, it's changing lives, but it's just about everything else that we're involved with. We can actually make fantastic inroads into what we do, into the health agenda, the collaboration work that we do with the police and the Northwest Ambulance. So there's a whole host of things that we need to make sure that whenever or if ever there is a change to the future of this authority, that we make sure that it's on the terms of agreement that we think is best for us for the future. So, I think it's right that we pause at this stage and we have those discussions. A report will be going to the combined authority, setting out some sort of further exploratory work, shall we say, and we'll be kept updated as that progresses. But as far as the authority is concerned, the committees and the lead members are concerned, I would suggest that things will stay as status quo for the time being, until sometimes as we can go forward on that and we can make future recommendations. And as I say, I will make sure that as authority we get it right.
Just chair, any rough time scales that you can find around this maybe?
The chief executive of Halton Council, David Parr, has spoken to myself and the chief constable and asked us to shared an initial report which set out a proposed way forward around an information gathering exercise and options identification exercise, which myself and the Chief Constable are being asked to go away and if you're going to set some questions to answer My understanding is that report would have was to be considered in November, but I believe that it was, that was deferred in order that the PCC could attend the meeting, so I probably need to defer to the PCC on that, and I think it would probably be better informed than I am. If you don't mind, Jim.
Well, I'll drop it in. There's an old saying which I got from the General Officer Commanding in Northern Ireland. He used to say, the best laid military plans only survive as long as the first round of grape shot. And it might be said that some of these talks almost immediately got into difficulty when I realised that the joint talks between the fire service and the police had only extended to Merseyside and had not included Cheshire Fire and Cheshire Police. So I asked for a pause on that until we could include them in any ongoing consultation. My interest in this, let me be absolutely clear, there's no personal interest in this going forward. However, there is a clear appetite to try, insofar as possible, to move towards a greater Manchester model. My personal view, for what it is worth, is that that is extremely difficult to achieve, given that any such move would require redrawing the boundary so that Halton would fall within the boundary of Merseyside, and that would effectively render Cheshire Police, because I don't know that the fire service, Cheshire Police would be barely liable. Viable. I've got the flu. That's my excuse. Barely viable.
May have been my first time.
and consequently, I know that the PCC in Cheshire is very concerned that there might be discussions taking place excluding them, and they would want to be included. So in terms of time frame, the danger is that this can go on for quite some time until we reach a point where we agree which options ought to be considered. At the root of it all, we should have as our absolute first priority, can we improve or reform the governance of these important public services and save money for the front line? And if we can do that, I think we are on a bound to try to do that, which is why I want to push back a little bit, Chair, on the idea that we park the work that's already been done. And the report does say on page 161 that the combined proposals would have delivered a saving of 102,000. And that is a not inconsiderable sum which would assist the fire brigade in the delivery of the service. And as it doesn't affect me, in a sense, because I would be a member of the fire authority, whatever the outcome, I do think it ought to be debated and considered before simply pushing it back. I'm sure this would assist the likes of the Director of Finance and the Chief Fire Officer in achieving this next year's savings. If good changes could be made that maintain good governance but improve the overall cost, reduce the overall cost of the governance.
Just as regards to the time scale, there's an enormity in the draft report that has gone to the planning authority. I think one of the problems that we had as well was trying to get the discussions between the police and the fire to make sure that whether it's evolved, how it's going to be, whether it's going to look like. Once it's agreed, signed up, the time goes to government and the government process kicks in, and then that's got to have parliamentary approval. So, at the moment, it's not priority because of what's going on with Brexit. The probably earliest might be around late 2020, is the earliest. Just depends on the chair of the government informed us. There's been some lessons learned from the Greater Manchester model and the discussions that are ongoing at the moment with West Midlands, which is a bit of a different model. and there's obviously discussions with the Greater London. But again, it's a different model again. So it's how it's fits for us and how we can fulfill our duties and obligations to the best that we possibly can from the service as the precious world financial and but the devolved powers that we'd expect to consider. So James quite right, the additional problems, the footprint of the Liverpool City region includes the services for police and fire is the footprint just from their side. So it's simple for us to say, you know, we can't influence or make a decision on what Holland will do. That's a matter for them, it's a matter for government to make that decision. We'd be asked as relevant as possible if the spoil fire can take on that section of the council. We could adequate resources and things like that, what we'll need to be done with the landlord. So there's that complication as well. So it's not straightforward. There's a lot of work to be undertaken. As the chief has highlighted, this will be head of the whole the chief executive, which is the executive part. So there's a lot of discussions that we have at the moment about how it's going to work, what is our last, what's going to be realistic, what could be the other, the task that what may be set. As regards to the fire and the budgets, and that was one of the things that I wanted to do, because as councillors that we need to look at savings, and people always say about councillors are looking after themselves. And this will be taken up as part of the we go towards our budget making process, and I've got our budget strategy today, which is in January 25th, which we'll go through various options to make sure that we can sort of have a balance budget, because our budget was set when we had a management plan, so it's set for 4 years, and this was an addition to other savings that we'd identified. But that's something that we can, you know, present to members to see if there's anywhere that we can improve savings, because we have, so since I've been appointed as chair of the authority, the changes that were made to date, I think we've saved in excess of £50,000 in that budget, on that budget line alone, which is quite a significant improvement to where we were. So we are going in the right direction, and you know, obviously it's open to scrutiny, and the finances are there for people to examine if they wish. But that will be taken up as part of the budget making process. And the budget is on the 20th. So that obviously we are the options before that. In the past, we normally set up a budget working party that we felt was a need to that. I didn't know that position when we were a few years ago because of everything that has been in place and everything we have managed to date. So we will be obviously the briefing on the 25th for the budget strategy day will be important. That's why everything in detail will be presented. And that's why we know not exactly what any of the pieces is going to be. Because the other flip side of that is that with the government budget statements a couple of weeks back, we won't actually know the detail of that until the 19th of December.
Yes,
so we're still waiting on that kind of detail to sort of finesse all the finances. So there's still some way to be done. That's why we can do that. But I think overall, as regards to the government's arrangements and where we stand, I think sort of suspending things for now until we go through all these options and what's available to ensure that we can work with. Because I know there's some things that have happened in Manchester that hasn't been played out.